Penguin Random House Audio presents On Our Best Behavior, The Seven Deadly Sins and the Price Women Pay to Be Good. This is the author, Elise Loehnen. For Peter, who had faith in me long before I had faith in myself, and whose death gave me faith in something much larger than myself. Author's note. This book is about how we're culturally programmed. I, too, of course, am a product of the culture in which I was raised. I am a white, straight, married mother, born in the United States to two heterosexual parents who are still married. I was raised in an upper-middle-class family, and I am upper-middle-class today. I identify as a woman, and other people, for the most part, identify me as a woman. I am fortunate that these identities feel accurate and that I can easily claim words to describe my experience. For many, the language we have to define who we are falls painfully short. I use the words women, woman, and we liberally in the following pages, but it's important that I state clearly, these words are shortcuts for an idea of what it means to be a woman, an idea that can be reductive and essentialist. My use of these terms is also framed by my own point of view, as a woman born in a female body. On these pages, I've attempted to interrogate our culture and the lives of as many women as possible, but it is not my intention to speak for all women, nor do I presume that I can. Yet I do believe our culture corrals all people who identify as women in universal ways. My hope is that this book will illuminate those ways. I've recounted events in my own life to the best of my memory's ability, and I've asked friends and family to fact-check me. I've anonymized some people per their requests throughout this book and changed some details to preserve identities. Introduction, Genesis. In late 2019, I hyperventilated for an entire month. I could not take a deep, complete breath without yawning, because, ironically, my lungs were oversaturated with oxygen. Hyperventilation is a classic mix-up between the body and the brain that I had been experiencing on and off since I was in my 20s. The first time it happened, I went to the emergency room thinking I had hours to live before I asphyxiated and that I needed to be intubated stat. The doctor advised me it was all in my head and sent me home with a pat on the back and a Xanax prescription. This recent spell was different. I couldn't nap it away. Cutting out caffeine offered no relief. I struggled and suffered, yawning and sighing through meetings, interviews, and meals. It's a strange experience to appear to the world as calm and sedate, sleepy really, while contending inside with consuming anxiety. I felt a bit like a duck, paddling frantically beneath the surface while appearing to glide with little effort on top. I sat in my therapist's office that month in exhausted tears. "I feel like I can't breathe," I said. "I know," he answered. "It's like I'm suffocating, like I've been buried alive." "Where is it in your body?" "It feels," I said, "as if something is sitting on my chest, and no matter what I do, I can't get it off." "That sounds really scary." We sat quietly. "I'm just so tired. I don't understand. I try to do it all right, to be perfect, to be everything for everyone." I paused to breathe before rushing out. "Why isn't that enough to give me some space? What more can I do to push this thing away?" I stopped, then asked, "Do you know what it is?" "I don't," he offered, "but I understand why you feel urgency to figure it out." "Is it the weight of my unreasonable expectations?" I asked. "Am I putting too much pressure on myself? Neither of those statements feel true to me, but you know me well." He looked at me. "I think you are trying to live up to some sort of saintly ideal, yes, but I think it's deeper, that if you feel like you're good enough, you'll be safe from judgment, loved." This observation hit right in my clenched heart. So what is sitting on my chest exactly? I asked. Whatever tells you that you're not. After our session, I sat in my car, head resting on the steering wheel. I could feel something primal and angry, something rebellious and pissed, break free. I was trying to be good. I had always been trying to be good. I ran myself ragged, cared dutifully for my family, friends, and colleagues, punished my body so that it stayed a certain size, kept my temper in check. What would happen if I just stopped? I didn't know the answer, but in my parked car that day, I resolved to find out. I planted a tiny seed, an inquiry that became the germ of this book. Its unfurling would cost me a lot, but it would give me back my life. I wish I could report that this revelation in my therapist's office was enough to break the spell, to unlabor my breathing, to provide relief. Sadly, admitting that I felt pinned down by something didn't disappear the phantom in the way that flipping on the lights when one of my kids sees a strange shadow at bedtime dissipates the threat. But acknowledging the specter's heft and weight did give shape to my investigation. Where did this beast come from? How did it get its power? And why was I so willing to submit? I began to trawl through history to locate the early murmurs of when goodness and acceptability were conjoined for women. And I revisited my own childhood to trace when this programming had first caught me in its maw. I've always liked asking questions. I was a precocious and curious child, probably a little annoying in my insistence to understand why. Fortunately for me, my mother used the library as a babysitter. I always had my face in a book. I looked for answers in novels, history, science, anywhere they might be hiding. And on the long drive to and from town every day, we lived in the woods up a valley outside of Missoula, Montana. My parents played NPR's All Things Considered, so I listened as masterful radio journalists like Cokie Roberts, Nina Totenberg, and Susan Stamberg used their questions to make the world more comprehensible. Now I realized I was trying to impose logic on a society that felt chaotic to me. I could sense an underlying structure, a code of behavior, a way life is supposed to be done. I needed to discern this map's contours, the boundaries of acceptance, belonging, and goodness, so I could pick the right path, one that might ensure my own safety, success, and survival. When I became an adult, I took jobs writing and editing, positions where I was paid to pursue my interests, to parse how systems work and why we do what we do. I've interviewed hundreds of deep thinkers and cultural influencers, doctors, scientists, theologians, therapists, activists, politicians, historians, healers, actors, poets, and journalists about what it means to be human. In the past decade, I've spoken to Brian Stevenson, the death row defense attorney who argues that we are better than the worst thing we've done, that no one deserves to be someone else's executioner. I've spent time with Laura Lynn Jackson, a famous psychic medium whose ability to channel the dead suggests we are part of a much larger energetic story, that we don't vanish but endure, that we are here in Earth School to learn, evolve, and grow. I've chatted with legendary historian Mary Beard about the silencing of women in literature throughout history, physician Gabor Mate about how intergenerational trauma drives addiction, U.S. Surgeon General Vivek Murthy on the epidemic of loneliness, historian Isabel Wilkerson about our unseen but pervasive racial caste system, marriage therapists John and Julie Gottman about why some couples are destined to divorce, and many, many more authors, philosophers, artists, and academics. If someone can offer an insight or clue into the human condition, I'll collect it, add it to my web. As I've reflected on these conversations, I've come to realize that on some level, everyone is saying the same thing. We all struggle to be known, to express the truest, most tender parts of ourselves, to feel safe enough to bring our gifts to bear. We wonder, who am I? What do I want and need? How do I find my purpose and serve? Our greatest imperatives are to belong, to love and be loved in return. Yet life gets in the way. Sometimes interference comes from tangible constraints that are outside our control. Traumatic childhoods, systemic injustice, natural disasters.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.